Hello, everybody.
Hello.
You enjoying your day?
Yes.
Thank you very much to the Lung Foundation for this wonderful gathering. I think it's one of the nicest we've had in a few years. And it's so lovely to travel around the countryside and come to us, don't you think?
Yes.
So a big clap of applause for the girls. And my name is Melissa, and I'm a person living with pulmonary arterial hypertension. Has anyone heard of it?
Yeah.
Well done. I'm so pleased to hear that. Well, generally, between 1 and 15 people in a million can go on to develop pulmonary hypertension. It is a rare and progressive serious disease. There is no cure. But there are now more than 14 therapies available in the world today. A decade ago, there was maybe one or two. So the biggest problem that we're facing today with pulmonary hypertension is lack of awareness, which means that diagnosis takes far longer than it should, which leads to a much longer, you're further along in your disease process, which means you're harder to treat and it's hard to restore your quality of life. So pulmonary hypertension is high blood pressure in the arteries of the lung that leads to heart failure in some cases. The thing that I really would like to share with you today is the secondary categories don't often get talked about. Pulmonary hypertension is the umbrella disease, and under that there are classifications within that. And the most important ones within that to take note of is if you have another condition that could lead to you developing pulmonary hypertension. Now in my case, I'm idiopathic, which means they don't know why I developed my disease. But it can be developed through certain drugs and toxins. We have wives and husbands who are farmers who've developed it through the toxins and the dirt and the chemicals they used on their farms. That's one example. Connective tissue disease is another example. Very rarely HIV infection. Portal hypertension, which is liver disease, and it's usually autoimmune. Congenital heart diseases, we know lots of babies are born with those. The schistomyosis worm is actually the biggest cause of pulmonary hypertension in the world today, and it comes from the African countries. You can have persistent pH of the newborn, which is developed during pregnancy. We have pH due to left heart disease. We have COPD, which can lead to pH. Interstitial lung diseases. And we have chronic thromboelic, which is basically blood clots in the lungs. If you had a blood clot in the lung or the leg, you're also more prone to develop pulmonary hypertension. And a few others, but those are probably the main ones for pulmonary hypertension. So today, as you know, I'm the fill-in, so bear with me because I haven't done a PowerPoint before. So I will be referring a little bit to my notes. Okay. So about 10 years ago, I was recently married. I was a late bride. I found the love of my life. We were married, we built a house, we started a business, we worked our butts off, we were earning good money, we were having a wonderful time. And then about 3 years in, I started to feel quite breathless and went to see a few doctors and a few things were said. And over the next few years, I became more and more breathless to the point where I couldn't even turn over in bed without gasping for breath. By the end of the 3 years, I was actually in a wheelchair. And when you're in advanced heart failure, you gain a great deal of fluid. This is something that was mistaken for morbid obesity, and the recourse offered after 3 years and about 8 doctors, 2 of them were respiratory specialists, was that I needed to have a lap band because I was in denial, or it was a psychiatric condition. That wasn't uncommon, and it's not uncommon even today. But we are managing to dispel some of those myths, and we're having more and more people diagnosed, which is saving lives. So I went in and I got put into the children's ward of all places at Murdoch Hospital, and then I didn't wake up. That's the last thing I remember. So apparently my family were all called to the hospital. I was in ICU. She's not going to make it. We don't know why. Something going on with her heart. I'm not sure what. Because it says she's had a heart attack, but she hasn't. And we were really lucky that there was a guy there that had just started working with the pulmonary hypertension in the pulmonary hypertension field. And him and the cardiologist came to the ICU, where I was hooked up to everything. and said, let's give her a cardio echogram and test her pulmonary pressures. Now, you've all heard of blood pressure. The ideal is 80 over 120. Well, for lung pressure, it's about 15. So 15 over 25, okay? You start to go above that, they start to ask questions. Well, mine was 96. So that kind of explained why I was breathless. I had about 12% cardiac output, so technically I should not have survived the surgery. So, long story short, it was quite a relief to be told I had a terminal disease, because I finally knew I wasn't going crazy. And it wasn't obesity, it was fluid retention. So then started my journey. What was the first thing you do? You ask for help, and you ask questions. And there was no one to answer my questions, and there was no support group, and the internet scared the living daylights out of me. So then you sort of sit at home waiting to die, and that doesn't happen. So then you get dark and twisty because you can't live the life that you planned. And then your doctor says to you, well, stop complaining and do something about it. So that's when we formed the first support group that was independent to any hospital called Pulmonary Hypertension in Western Australia. And over the years, we have developed multiple resources, and we won some really prestigious grants to produce resources that weren't available. And we're really pleased now that the Lung Foundation have developed a whole new range of resources just for pulmonary hypertension, and we're now on the map. So I'm so grateful. Look at that, it works. I'm so grateful to them for actually finally recognising this rare disease, which I believe wouldn't be quite so rare if doctors knew how to diagnose it and it wasn't so similar to so many other diseases. So the problem in Australia is there's no real one body taking care of just PH patients. I'm a firm believer that we need to turn to our peak bodies, and in this case that's the Lung Foundation, and the peak body for support groups, and that's what we did, and that's why we formed the network. So our job is to gather all the information, find out where all the support is, get our hands on as many resources as we can, and then bring everybody together in one place, which is usually your website, Facebook, Instagram, and we do hard copy. We will never ever miss out anybody who isn't connected online, and share that information out with everybody in the community. And that means state to state and around the globe. And that's been really, really successful. And we are part of a global network now that has managed to reduce the diagnosis time from 3.5 to about 2.8 years. It's not a lot, but it's better than it was. So, I'm now part of an incredible team of people who all support my crazy vision and put up with my running around madly with ideas coming out of my head constantly. And we have recently formed the Pulmonary Hypertension Network Australia, so we've gone outside of WA and we're now becoming a national incorporated body. So it's a pretty big step, and we are here, we see our roles supporting the Lung Foundation and in supporting our community as a whole on our level. So looking to a unified community. So everyone here who's got a chronic disease, whether it's lung or something else, will all be able to relate to just how much you are impacted day to day with your symptoms, with your medications, with fatigue, with breathlessness. There's a huge impact on you socially. I know I personally found out who my real friends were. I was the girl that no one wanted to hang out with because she's dying, and that's too confronting. Anyone else been in that position? Yeah. So it's imperative that when you live with this disease, you find a way to cope with it. And that can take years to cope. Like I said, I spent years dark and twisting, and I thought, well, this is just tiring, waiting to die. I need to find something else to do. So, you know, you go to your review and they're constantly telling you how sick you are, so you're just waiting for it to happen. And when it doesn't, it's actually quite frustrating. So I became quite passionate about sharing all things pulmonary hypertension. I had to teach myself so many new skills that I never thought I would learn or have the opportunity to learn. I learned how to build and run a website. I love it. I learned how to put together and edit and produce a magazine. I had to go out and find sponsors. I had to start networking, literally, on boots on the ground. And I found some amazing people in our community who were really willing to step up, even though it was lung disease. Because, hey, lung disease is not sexy. And you asked for it, because you must smoke. Every question I get when someone sees me on this, were you a smoker? I don't care if you smoke. Like Sharon said, we all deserve the same care. So this new campaign, which you'll see here, Tegan, she's actually a nurse with pulmonary hypertension. I wonder if anyone asks her if she's smoked. It's just busting the myths. And I think the more of us that can do that and break down and educate, the easier it will probably get overall. So if you need to learn new ways to make changes in your life, what are some of the changes that you've made in your lives to help you cope with your diagnosis?
Jenny.
Jenny Abraham, everyone, the life support group.
Although I didn't develop pulmonary hypertension, I did get lung disease suddenly at 48, having never smoked, having been the only non-smoker in my family. I got damaged lungs from it, very bad pneumonia. And the one thing I was grateful for was that I didn't have to stop a lot of the things I enjoyed. I wasn't a dance instructor. I didn't do a lot of physical activity. I didn't do any physical activity. But I became a convert after pulmonary rehab. I found the best thing to do was to find things that I could still do and not mourn about anything I could no longer do or I found difficult. It was to focus on the things that I could continue to do. What were my strengths? These things. So do something like that. Don't worry about what you can't do, because there's a lot more that you can do than what you can't do.
Yeah. And some of the stuff you couldn't do comes back from your stable. Has anyone found that? Things that you couldn't do, you can suddenly do once you're stable more? What other coping skills have you developed? Anyone? There's a prize. Just take your time. Have you found that doing normal tasks, you're still using the time limit that you think it should have been done in? Like clean the house, 3 hours. Clean the house, 3 weeks. Now I've got to start again. She's so unsatisfying. So I do what you call serving everyone. Competition is up. Distract. Fresh flowers. Look how they pretty. Does anybody ask for help? Wow.
Sometimes.
Yes. Okay. Can you put your hands up, those of you who ask for help? Okay, so. More not than do. Yeah. I think that's a really big thing. I find it really hard to ask for help. It's even because of my age, and I don't look sick. Take away the oxygen, take away the medicine pump that is literally keeping me alive. It's got a tube going into my chest, pumping medicine into me every minute. You get some interesting reactions from people when they see it. Oh. And I get patted a lot. You're so brave. You're brave to be out in public. Yeah, I've had that problem a few weeks ago. I'm just scared of her. Okay. But you do get allowed in front of queues. Yeah, take advantage of that, people. I also, though, have an acronym permit, but I still, and I have big devils in my car talking about invisible disease. And I have still been abused about 3 or 4 times for using the acronym bar. Has anyone else experienced that? Yeah. You feel like you've got to justify everything, and if you're having a really good day, God forbid that you should stride into the shopping centre. Someone's going to see you. God damn it. Yeah, exactly. So, and I often know people feel guilty. Who feels guilty for being sick? God bless you, Jenny. Jenny doesn't feel guilty. Okay, staying active. Easier said than done. You can't breathe. You're in a lot of pain. Fatigue. Oh, God, the fatigue. Okay.
this disease doesn't have you, you have this disease. That's a process to get to that. And it can change every day. I came up with a rule that I can only wallow 7 minutes at a time. I don't know why I think 7 minutes, but I'm here. And I shared that with quite a few different people. And one of the nurses who was taking care of me on a regular basis, she actually was diagnosed with a really rare heart complaint. And she had a pacemaker, her whole world turned upside down. And while she was freaking out during her process, she remembered that I'd said to her she could only wallow 7 minutes at a time. So she said that's what kept her going. And then I became inspiration for moving forward, because as my husband likes to say to me, toughen up, princess, it could always be worse. So I know some days it doesn't feel like it could be any worse. I really do. I think you need to stop and acknowledge those times. But don't fall into the all or nothing trap. I'm still a work in progress. I'm a workaholic. So if I start a project, I have to finish it. I've usually started at least two more while I'm working on that one. Things that you can do, scrapbooking, art therapy, music, singing is actually really good for people with lung diseases. Did you know that? Yeah. What sort of hobbies have you managed to maintain? I love decorating the house, which my husband's horror. Come on, Jenny, don't let me pull on you again. What kind of hobbies do you have?
Well, I've always been human balance, and there's no problem with balance.
So who goes online a lot to keep you to time? Yeah, it's hours and hours of fun. Pinterest, you get lost in that for hours. So has anyone else got any tips that they use to pass the time when they're really bad?
Yes. Yeah, I took action on creative pursuits that I had in the jungle.
You're creating what?
Pursuit.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I do poetry.
Oh, wonderful. Poetry. Yeah, we have a member who does poetry. She writes poems late at night, which is going to be our multi poet. Yeah, and I find it often takes your mind right away from how you're feeling, and hours pass and you tend to feel a little bit better. So, and get involved. We get so isolated. Get involved, get out there, go to your support groups. We don't sit there and cry, we have a lovely time. We have raffles, we have a nice lunch, we talk. It's fantastic. Yeah. We get more. Jenny comes to do guest speaking, we generally do deep breathing exercise. And try not to dwell on what you can no longer do, but focus on what you can do. And that's a daily thing. You'll wake up and feel particularly revolting. But, okay, there goes that list of chores that I wanted to achieve today. Okay, which one can I do? And if you can't do any, find a great activity, listen to some music, watch a DVD. The world's not going to end if you can't finish that list. So who practices self-care? Oh my God, nobody.
Yeah.
Come on, Dad. Yeah. Okay, so self-care is really important for the patient or the person living with the disease, which is the PCT, and their carers. Carers get so tired, so burnt out, so just putting themselves last. So as patients, we need to recognise they need their time, downtime too. And there's many things you can do. Following your medication routine, going to pulmonary rehab, reading a book. You can have a stay in your pajamas day. There was a reason that we wore our pajamas when we were little and stayed home for school. Because it feels good. Yes. Isn't it? It feels cozy and safe in your pajamas. Lie down and sit up, it doesn't matter. Take the elevator, people. The stairs are for the teenagers. Okay? don't do it to yourself. Because if you think, oh, I'll be courageous. You could ruin the outing you're going out on because you're exhausted.
I'm always going to go to
the if you want to take instance, but don't do it just because you think you have to. Because we're in a fit obsessed culture. Who has to cancel their plans a lot? Doesn't it suck? Yeah. Especially when you're looking forward to it. But I think you'll find most people. I get creative after a while, and you get people to come to you. And sometimes they get a little upset about always having to come to you. But that's how you keep the social circles going. Or you get a friend to come pick you up and take you to where you're going. Make sure you've got the Acrod needs covered. The Crown Casino has free parking for people with Acrod parents. Did you know that? And you can go and have a lovely lunch there and a few hours of entertainment. I'm not encouraging gambling, I'm actually talking about eating. Yeah, so just find those places. Have a stay-at-home spa day or a staycation. Watch videos, bring girlfriends around and have a good chat. Men get together at the men's shed. Watch a football game together. Oh, sorry, it's very sexist. I was just thinking about talking about that. Sorry, wives. Have fun. Try and cut that negativity out of your life as much as you can. And cheat it with a treat. You're supposed to do that occasionally, daily. My daily treat is I like espresso coffee. The little ones with the heavy cream on and with a little cookie. That's my thing. I look forward to that each time. Square of dark chocolate. So you can still have a little cheat. You look forward. Something you look forward to. Has anyone got anything they like to do? Chocolate's good for you. That's a good one.
Before you weren't allowed to, just
any other things people do to keep themselves going through the day?
Yeah.
I've noticed being sick, as sick as I am, can make, especially with multitude of side effects, the lovely hot rash that I break out into because of the Viagra. Yes, we're going to take Viagra too. The headache, the jaw pain, the nausea, the diarrhea, the gastric upset. The nosebleeds, they go on for hours. The fatigue. So it is an ongoing lesson in flexibility. And I'm sure all of you here today have got something that prevents you from doing what you enjoy and trying to manage your energy levels. So conserving your energy, like I said, take the elevator. Okay, be really careful of going out into the heat or too cold. For pH patients, it's usually the heat because your heart has to work harder. Set realistic goals. Don't try and do three different appointments on one day and push through shopping and go out for dinner. That could result in a hospitalisation. Improve your home. Get the aids that you need to help you out in the bathrooms. Raise things up so you don't have to bend down. I've often found that bending over is really difficult. Makes my breathing exacerbate. Does anyone else have that problem? Have you bent over? Yeah, you've got that problem. Let your groceries come to you. Go online. It's fun. You go down the grocery aisles, you do it online. You spend a bit more money though. But it's funny. It's delivered. They can bring it in. Did you all know that if you want your rubbish bin put out, you don't have to do it yourself when you contact the council? So just ask. Like I asked the other day, go to the chemist. Do you deliver? Yes, and for free. Don't forget to just save you that trip out, pick up your meds. Try and whatever you can do to conserve your energy, ask the questions to see if they can help you, they can come to you. Because I find it quite difficult to leave the house. I'm sure a lot of you do too. Who turns to friends and family for help? Who doesn't have anyone to turn to for help? So you need to try and lock into services that are available to you. It's usually through HAC, Home and Community Care, or your local community services department that can send someone out to talk about volunteer transport, things like that. And take advantage. If you want to go out for the day and say to one of the major shopping centres, a lot of them have those scooters. Has anyone got a scooter? A gopher? Oh my God, they're so much fun. So definitely get one of those, pile all your stuff into it, and go shop to shop in a gopher. No, it's free. You do have to provide details of who you are. Sure, so you ask for and receive more. I think we all need to feel validated. We need to be heard.
We need to listen as well as patients. We need to sympathise and empathise, encourage and have patience. It's not a perfect cycle. They fall out with each other, and carers and family. Some people are going to say, well, you know, you're always using your illness as an excuse. Has anyone had that? Yeah?
I actually would say to my family, complaints to come, it's close, you know, because on Friday, you've got 5 minutes.
Her complaints to come, it's close. Yeah, process. And developing patience is another good one. That comes in time. Just be kind to yourself as often as you can. And get everyone to help out, even small children. They don't know slave labor is illegal. And try to be positive and proactive in your own care. Like I said, you can only wallow for 7 minutes at a time. Okay, get connected. If you're not online, find out if you can go online. It's never too late to learn these skills. You'd be surprised what's out there. And try and manage your stress. Yeah, easier said than done, I know. But there are many, many coping techniques that are available to us now, from meditation to deep breathing to music therapy. So try and keep your routine as constant as you can, especially your sleep, your nutrition, your rest. Who spends a lot of time in bed? Who spends a lot of time sitting in a chair? Who does exercise every day? Well, look who's showing up. That's fantastic. Now, before we get into this, just travelling with oxygen, I'm actually not allowed to travel. But an amazing resource was produced a year or so ago. Once again, by the lovely Jenny Abraham and the Institute for Respiratory Health. And we have that on our website. I'm quite sure it's on your website. But there's an amazing guide that takes you from the A to Z of travelling with oxygen. So if you're someone who likes to travel or you've been afraid to travel, Jenny is your girl, okay? She can help you with that route to find that resource, or it's on our website, okay? So you can ask for that later. Now, you must. The first thing you do is not book a ticket to Hawaii. You must ask the doctor, can I travel? Do I need an altitude test? Do I need to fly with oxygen even though I don't wear oxygen every day? Things like that. Can I travel to this country? What if the altitude's too high? You're going to spend the whole time unconscious or fainting. Well, that's going to do it. Is my type of treatment, because it's so rare, is it available in the country I want to visit? So these are the sorts of things you need to take into consideration. Make a plan, stick to it. You've got to have all your travel documents. So you've also got to have all your medications on you in the plane, just in case. You've got to have all your letters from the clinic, you've got to have all your emergency letters. Just think things through. There is a checklist, okay? And most important thing, tell the airline that you won't be flying with oxygen, because they all have a different policy. Okay, I'm sure Jenny can add to that.
Yeah, you have to really stay flexible about that, because even though they have a policy, the day you go, the crew that's on the plane, they're going to speak differently from the odd trip back. They just deal with it. They don't all understand.
Allow extra time. We move slowly. Remember that.
So
allow lots of time. Ask for a wheelchair to be available. Book one if you need to. Make sure it's available. Again, carry your supplies with you and your carry-on luggage, just in case your real luggage doesn't make it to your destination. And what something else we recommend, whether it's by car, rail, or plane, is to try and be active at least every 2 hours, because we want to avoid blood clots. And we need a good stretch. That's good for us. Stick to your plan, have fun, enjoy your trip. So know your body, know what makes you feel good, what doesn't. Keep a journal, particularly if you can't figure out why you're gaining weight, it's a good way to show the doctor. And in my case, that would be really handy to prove that it was fluid. In our case, I don't know about generalism, but in our case, salt is a big no-no. fluid intake. Is anyone here on fluid restrictions? So you monitor your fluid intake, which is really hard because that includes things like watermelon, which are watery. And during the summer, and I don't know about you, but I have constant dry mouth. And all I want to do is drink. And you get to that 1.5-2 litre limit pretty quickly, particularly when it's hot and dry. So managing nausea and vomiting is another thing. If you look at natural supplements, always check with your team before you take anything over the counter. Yes, ma'am.
So when you've got monitoring fluid intake, you mean you're not supposed to take too much?
Yes, limit your fluid intake. If you are on fluid restrictions, which I am, so they ask you to try not to have fluid over 1.5 litres. You know how you're always told, drink 8 glasses a day or 2? Well, not all of us are allowed to do that because it can exacerbate your heart failure and your condition. Not everyone, just in certain people. Okay, so you're supposed to limit your stimulants, alcohol, coffee. Who has trouble with the coffee? And of course, when they keep telling you that a glass of wine is good with dinner, we should believe them. But limit that too. Okay. And we're often quite iron deficient, particularly because of medications. They tend to reduce your iron in your body, so you need to have a diet rich in iron, or you need to be checked regularly with blood tests to make sure that you don't need an infusion. And reduce your amount of vitamin K. That's usually when you're on blood thinning tablets. You have to be quite careful what you eat when you're on warfarin and things like that. Anyone here on warfarin and things like that? Yeah, so you just need to be a little bit careful with that. Research has shown that exercise is actually very good for you, but that doesn't mean you should run out and join the local 24/7 gym. What it means is you need to talk to your team and ask to go to the physiotherapy department and be assessed for the appropriate program just to be tailored for you. So start slowly. I know a lot of us are all or nothing with that as well, so that you don't end up aching muscles. We do need to avoid certain activities. In my case, or PH patients' cases, we're not really encouraged to move our arms and our legs at the same time, so no lifting weights while running on the spot, because it draws the oxygen away from the heart and it can actually put more pressure on the heart.
So what about swimming?
Swimming, yeah. I can't actually swim because of my pump, and I've found if I do get into if I immerse myself in a bath, the pressure on my chest is so uncomfortable I can't stay in the bath. So that's me as a PH patient. So I know other people who swim and they don't have a problem. I don't think they're meant to be doing massive amounts of laps or anything like that. Don't be alone. Take on a buddy until you feel comfortable, especially those of us that are prone to fainting or dizziness, low blood pressure. So you don't really want to go on your own. You want to go somewhere that you can be monitored. The easiest thing to do with that, I go down to the local shopping centre and I walk up and down the aisles of the supermarket. Anyone else do that? It's fun. It's fun. You walk around, you smile at people, you chat over the products. Maybe that's just me.
Buy too much?
Hey?
Buy too much?
Oh, God, yeah. Yeah, buy far too much. Okay. And avoid exercising in extreme temperatures, like really, really cold or particularly really, really hot. Does anyone notice when it gets humid, you feel like a guppy that can't breathe? Yeah, so that's why. So try and have your air conditioning. And please stop exercising if you don't feel well. And if you've got a pulse oximeter, you can wear that like you do when you go for your rehab or your 6-minute walk test, which is something we have to do. We're monitored to see how our heart rate goes. And always wear your oxygen if you're using oxygen therapy while exercising, because your oxygen will drop and that will put more pressure on your heart. Okay, self-talk. Yeah, here's a good one. Who's got fabulous self-talk? Nobody. So when you're sick, I found it's even harder to leave the house, especially when you're bloated with fluid, you can't breathe. You you have a phlegm ball in your throat, you can't move, and you have to cough every 5 minutes. In my case, I have to sniff a lot because I'm not allowed to blow my nose, because if I do, it bleeds. So, all the time. It's just gross. But I apologise in advance, but that's my thing. I've heard people who've got phlegm globules who sit in the elevator and go, oh, my people thinking, you know. So I'm sure all of you can relate to something along those lines. Coughing, yeah, with a weird cough. So I'm often going out, people will try and touch me because the line, you can't see it now, but it used to be nearly in the middle of my chest. People would go, oh, what's that? So you tend to sort of shrink away and stay home, and your body image is already difficult enough. So then you have to try and be more realistic about how you're going to approach things. pH of body image. Especially if you're young. If you're a young person diagnosed and you're going on a date, I've heard members say to me, oh, I'm sitting there on my date, oxygen beside me, and every waitress that comes past asks me why I'm on oxygen. So her whole day became about why she was sick. So has anyone else experienced that?
It's possibly because we're older.
Does anyone get asked questions when they go out and when they're wearing the oxygen? Do you get asked questions?
Yeah.
What kind of question?
Children will ask me why I've got this up my nose.
Have you ever noticed how children are just so, what's that, mummy? And mummy is just like, nothing, darling, nothing, instead of educating them. And I usually say, I'm a superhero. This is my superpower. Shh, don't tell anyone. And their mothers are sort of like, and some people I just say, it helps them breathe, and then they usually have more questions. So, but yeah, I always try and educate, even when I feel like crap. Someone says, what's that? What's that for? And I get a lot of people coming up to me asking me where I get my oxygen covers from and stuff like that. And I use every opportunity to educate people. And people stare at you because you've got your oxygen, particularly when you're younger. And that was particularly hard. But as someone who was an opera singer who used to sing on the stage a lot, I'm used to having people stare at me. So I have to pretend I'm famous. It just helps you get, whatever helps you get through the day,
okay?
Except what you can't change. Okay, I'm never going to be twiggy. Dress up, show up, enjoy yourself. Okay, one thing I have learned through being diagnosed with this delightful disease is it's time to enjoy your life. Stop saying, I'm on a diet. Stop saying, I'm going to do that when. Just do it. Just enjoy it. Just relax, people. Does anyone else still put that pressure on themselves? No? You're finding you're all pretty accepting? You can tell me. What kind of pressure do you put on yourself? That's really hard, isn't it? Yeah. Losing that physical aspect to living each day, being able to keep up. Make positive changes wherever you can. Be good to your body. Yes, that includes sleeping, eating, exercising, but it also means be good to your mind. Staying active, you can also stay active mentally as well. I found that has been my biggest hero. Although I think I was just given up. Having a cause, having a passion, something you really enjoy that you just can't wait to get up to each day. Who's got that?
Yeah.
Okay. People, you need to try and find that. Doesn't matter what it is. Go and read to blind people. Go and visit children in this big hospital that you see in the hospital. There is so much you could do. Okay. Celebrate your accomplishments. Who does that? Oh, that's tragic. Oh, guys. Celebrate everything. Get out the good china. Put on the good jewellery.
I buy a watch.
Hey?
Yeah, I buy a watch. My wife does.
My weakness is ring. And change the way you talk and think about yourself. Okay. For patients, get connected. support groups, online, in person. They're out there. The Lung Foundation has a list of all of them. Connect Groups, Support Group Association, WA, has the biggest database in the country for support groups. They're an amazing group of people. It's a support group for anything. You can just ring them, go online, and you can find it. Remember to be proactive within your treatment. Get involved, ask questions. Doctors don't always like that. I've been told on numerous occasions you ask far too many questions, Mrs. Dumitru. It's my life. I want to know what was happening to you. You'd want to know. Don't be intimidated. Take your carers in with you. It is your legal right. Did you know that? Okay. Learn to manage your stress. Look into supplements, but always, always check with your treatment team before you take anything in case there are any contraindications. Now for our lovely caregivers, educate yourself about who you're taking care of. Validate when they talk. You don't always have to have the answer. Just listen. Sympathise. Encourage. Have patience. Help out. Be positive and proactive. But take time out, especially if you are ready to explode. I know several carers at the moment who are so burnt out and they're sick too. Who here is a carer and also has an illness? Yeah, that's particularly tricky. So Carers WA have some wonderful support groups again, and resources and outings and training sessions, and they've got online counselling and all sorts of things available to you. So, does anyone have any questions? Yes?
I think you said, I got the impression that in your early stages, your condition just wasn't recognised, wasn't diagnosed. Because the specialists were either not equipped enough or not interested. What's the situation now? Can you recommend that?
Oh, yes. Yes. If you've got pulmonary hypertension, you need to be treated by particular teams of doctors and nurses. That is imperative. The medications you receive are only available to these clinics, and that's for a reason. They know which tests to run, and they know how to categorise where you fall in the classification. They have all the current information. So your GP can send you for a cardio echo, and if he says, okay, your pressures are up, then he needs to refer you to a specialist within the field, and you'll find those on our website. Yeah. Anything else?
I was the biggest thing I find in the past is
Yeah. We actually have a young member, she's 26, and she's refused to leave the house because her oxygen bottle is huge. And her husband found her oxygen glasses from America, and they're just glasses, and the oxygen runs behind and comes down, so you can't see it, barely in touch. And she's got a little machine, and she's like a handbag. So that's one option. I can find out where she got them from. My oxygen covers, I'm very, very blessed to have some amazing sponsors who support us within our community. And the manager of the Guardian Pharmacy at Lansdowne, she actually is really crafty. And she makes all my covers for me. And I've actually got a Christmas tree that has blinking lights as well. That's really cool. Get lots of attention in the
center. We had a member who wanted to see how a group could somehow turn oxygen.
Yeah.
Instead of trying to
disguise,
you should just accentuate the
light. Yeah, they're going to look at you anyway,
so go for it.
Another way, like they can colour them. Yeah, oh, Lisa, could you imagine if they were all glittery? Maybe not for the guys. Or football colours. Hey, come on, guys. Football colours? Yeah. Soccer?
Yeah.
Way
of looking more attractive,
but not climbing. Because there's nothing bigger fashion killer than having this palm. And it's heavy, stuck around your body 24/7, in the shower, in the bed, everywhere. So, yeah, make a handbag for it. Get the glue gun out, the glitter, and yeah. I said that, yeah. I should have made a killing. I think they're quite detailed.
I think there are some very good covers for oxygen bottles on Etsy online.
So we should start with
Yeah, and you know how you get the knitters to get together and they make all those lovely things to give to the little children at the family. Maybe we can get a group together. We've done that in the past when we did the elephant in the room. We had little elephants with magnets for adoption certificates and just to raise awareness about the disease. So, yeah, it's quite a chat to me about it. Look at that. No, I don't like it.
There are patterns that
we want. Yeah, we'll talk to them, but she knows it more about it. Yes, Donna.
Could you just repeat how one finds you on the bed? Or how you find your body when you go to the top?
www.phna.info. Nice and easy. Info. It's up on the screen. We're on Pinterest, we're on Instagram, we're on Facebook. We have the most changed website in the world. I change it every week, and I draw people into it through the Facebook page. We have a 20-page magazine that we produce and a sponsored page we printed. And people that are very housebound report back how grateful they are to receive that, because they get to see the pictures, they get to see the events, and all this fun stuff that they get to do together as a community, and they don't feel like they've missed out. So there's loads of resources available to you. And Jay Abraham is the coordinator and support group leader for Life Support Group under the Institute of Respiratory Health. I'm sure a lot of you know her. And she is a font of information. So please feel free to come and talk to either one of us.